and working 10 years in higher ed and 22 years as a diversity educator, all of that creates the second level, which is my viewpoint on the world, my conscious and unconscious biases. That causes me, usually on an unconscious level, to behave in ways that I'm not even aware of toward other people. Hopefully, they're micro positive messages toward people that are different than me, but sometimes if I'm not mindful, the behavior that might flow out of me looks like a micro inequity. It looks like a snub. It looks like a, you know, people around the meeting are like, really? Did he just say that? And if you call me on it, it's coming out of my unconscious mind. Hopefully, it's not conscious. What would be my reaction if you call me on the fact that I rolled my eyes when a female was presenting her ideas? What would probably be my reaction? Did I roll my eyes? And if I acknowledged it, then I would say, I didn't mean anything by it. That's the essence of the behavioral outcome of unconscious bias, is when we call people on it, they often go, oh, I didn't mean anything by it. And they're being honest. They didn't mean anything by it. That's this part of the brain. It came out of the unconscious part of the brain. So these micro messages set up advantages and disadvantages for people. If I'm constantly getting positive micro messages, my engagement goes up. I keep sharing ideas. If I keep getting those subtle negative messages, and women and people of color receive them way often, the micro negative messages, the person who created the term micro inequity calls it death by a thousand paper cuts. It's not like, ugh, I'm gonna report that to someone. It's, ugh, man, here we go again, right? And women are often on the receiving end of these micro messages. So it creates inclusion or exclusion depending on the outcome. So usually in our classes we have you jump on your phone and research what a micro inequity is. We don't have time. I'll tell you the definition. I love this definition from Mary Rowe, 1973. They're apparently small events which are often ephemeral. Great word. They float in the air like, you know, dust. They're hard to prove. They're often covert, often unintentional, and they're frequently unrecognized by the perpetrator, which occur wherever people are perceived to be different. So I really just kind of gave you some examples of that. We're all guilty of micro inequities at some point in our career. I think I have a bunch of examples, and I'm only going to hit a couple of them. Expecting women in meetings to take notes. You're like, I know of what you speak, right? Expecting women to plan the social events for the team, right? Assuming everyone in the organization gets sports metaphors or is even interested in sports, and that includes men who aren't interested in sports, right? A lot of women love sports, a lot of men don't love sports, so that's an assumption. Where are you from? Oh, I'm from Columbus, Georgia. No, where are you really from, right? When we're talking about culture and ethnicity, right? You can kind of see these, you know. Shortening someone's name because you can't exactly pronounce it, so you just give up and give them a nickname. That's a micro inequity. We love our name. Learn my name. If you can't pronounce it, ask me and we'll practice it a few times. I'll draw it out phonetically. Scott. You got it? So these are floating around everywhere. They're in every organization, not just here, not just at Coca-Cola, they're everywhere.